was finally caught using a fake identity to apply for credit. He was sent to a borstal, a young offenders institution. Heath thrived in the detention centre and was given roles with leadership opportunities by the governor, who eventually helped with Heath's application to the Air Force 2 years later. The Air Force rejected Heath's application due to his criminal record, and instead he joined the Royal Army Service Corps, the unit which kept the British Army supplied with food and weapons. Heath was stationed in the Middle East, where he continued with his fraudulent activities. He was court-martialed when it was discovered he was misusing service uniforms and medals. During the journey home, he jumped off the ship when it docked in Johannesburg, South Africa, and fled, and took on the alias of Captain Selway for a few months. He then joined the South African Air Force and took on another alias, Lieutenant Colonel James Armstrong. After flying a few missions for the Air Force, his cover was exposed and he was sent back to England in January 1946. When he arrived back in London, he applied to join the Royal Institute of Navigation to become a commercial pilot. He was accepted onto the course and began his studies, but towards the end of the program, the school found out about his criminal past and his discharge from the army. He was removed from the course, and tutors told him that he would never become a pilot. Over the years, Heath had been writing letters to his family, bragging about his progress in the army and his change of studies to become a commercial pilot, and he continued to lie about his endeavours. Neville Heath wrote many letters throughout his lifetime, and they often arrived in the hands of his victims after he committed a crime, explaining why he did whatever the crime was. Because of Heath's demeanour and good looks, the many victims of fraud and deceit often forgave him and never went to the police. Instead of studying, 29-year-old Heath was spending his days in dance halls and pubs, drinking until late. According to Harry Proctor, a journalist for the Sunday Pictorial, which is now known as the Sunday Mirror, Neville Heath and John Haig, who is the acid bath murderer, often drank in the same pubs in London. Heath had rented a room at Pembridge Court Hotel in Notting Hill under his real name, adding a fake army title of Lieutenant Colonel for good measure. Because of his good looks and charming personality, Heath had no problem attracting young women, and he was a hit at the clubs. On the 15th of June 1946, Heath met 19-year-old Yvonne at a woman's Royal Navy service dance in Chelsea and took her to dinner in the hope of getting her to return to the hotel room with him. However, she refused, but they continued their evening regardless. The next day, they spent the whole day together connection with the death of Mrs. Gardiner at Notting Hill Gate. I booked in at the hotel last Sunday, but not with Mrs. Gardiner, whom I met for the first time during the week. I had drinks with her on Friday evening, and while I was with her, she met an acquaintance with whom she was obliged to sleep. The reasons, as I understand them, were mainly financial. It was then that Mrs. Gardiner asked if she could use my hotel room until 2 o'clock, and intimated that if I returned after that, I might spend the remainder of the night with her. I gave her my keys and told her to leave the hotel door open. It must have been almost 3 a.m. when I returned to the hotel and found her in the condition of which you are aware. I realised that I was in an invidious position, and rather than notify the police, I packed my belongings and left. Since then, I have been in several minds whether to come forward or not, but in view of the circumstances, I have been afraid to. I can give you a description of the man. He was aged approximately 30, dark hair, with small moustache, height about 5'9", slim build. His name was Jack, and I gathered he was a friend of Mrs. Gardiner, of some long standing. I have the instrument with which Mrs. Gardiner was beaten, and am forwarding this to you today. You will find my fingerprints on it, but you should also find others as well. N.G. Heath. On the 23rd of June, instead of going back to London or sending the whip, Heath travelled to Bournemouth, around 85 miles away from Worthing, where he checked into the Tollard Royal Hotel under the alias Group Captain Rupert Brooke. Doreen was born in Brentford in 1924. She had been suffering from measles and influenza, and her doctor told her that the sea air would help her illness. She had just arrived in Bournemouth for her short holiday. While walking along the promenade, she met Neville Heath, or Group Captain Rupert Brooke, who invited her for afternoon tea at his hotel, which she accepted. After tea and persistence from Heath, Doreen agreed to also have dinner with him later that night at the hotel. The pair ate in the lounge, and the night manager of the Tolliday said that Doreen was visibly uncomfortable in Heath's company. She was last seen going outside with Heath to get into a taxi that would take her back to her hotel. The next morning, the day manager got a call from the Norfolk Hotel where Doreen had been staying. She had not returned to the hotel that night, and they knew that she had been dining at the Tolliday. She had disappeared between the two hotels. Later that day, a woman was walking her dog on the beach when she saw a swarm of flies. Thinking nothing of it, the woman continued home, where she picked up the morning paper. In the news was the disappearance of Doreen Marshall, and she realised that she needed to revisit the beach. The woman and her father returned to the beach and found Doreen's body. She was naked In reality, Heath took Doreen down the beach, removed all of his clothing, and then attacked her. He then cleaned himself in the sea and went back to the hotel, where he climbed up the side of the building and back into his room. During his questioning, Heath asked if he could get his sports jacket from his hotel room as he was getting cold. Instead, one of the investigators went to retrieve the jacket and soon realised why Heath wanted the clothing in his possession. Doreen's train ticket